Dear participants, I'd like to introduce you Alexander Marseille from National University of Singapore, and he will perform the first, the second tutorial of this summer school for the next two sessions for today.
Hi guys. How is it?
So far, did you download any beta sets? Did you try to play with it?
Okay, my name is Alexander.
If you go back in the US, ask Alexander, nobody knows who it is. Everybody call me Alex. So,
so in Russian, it's not the same name. So, I was thought, what should I focus in this tutorial? Since we have so diverse and nice audience, along both social science and computer science directions, I thought not to be too technical, because that technology that I can explain in this short time wouldn't be too advanced for writing knowledge. At the same time, I don't want to be too abstract, because if I were too abstract, then it wouldn't be too useful for you, because you might need to work on these assignments and tasks for the following week. So I want to make it as efficient as possible. So I split my talk into two parts. In the first part, I'll run through the common ways how people process the data. Why it's important? Because the data sets that we organized for the school, so that you download, probably some of you signed up already for certain topics, they all data sets, that means they have the data inside. And this data very often is a multimodal and very diverse. We in our lab believe that we cannot longer assume that single data storage is sufficient enough for any real world application. So we believe that everything must be taken care of in 360 degree view. So we work with multi-source data. This data is multiple modalities, can be text, videos, locations, different types of semantic sensor data from variables. And this data must be properly processed. So the first part I will be addressing actually about data processing techniques. And the main aim for you is not to understand how you implement these things, because these things are actually available on the internet. You can find multiple libraries that can do that for you. But understanding the principle is very important, because if you understand what this particular feature or data representation means, it will help you to draw good conclusions out of the data and out of your tasks, which is the ultimate goal of this school. You want to come out with meaningful conclusions, and we are not looking for results like, well, this model outperformed another one for 2%, and I don't know why, but yeah, we are very happy. So this is not kind of results we are looking for, especially in the web science. So That's why I put it in this way. And the second part will be about applications on this data for different, mostly CL direction tasks, because our lab is more about computer science and social science. However, I will be asking you questions, and many of these questions I myself don't know answer, and I'm looking for your help. Because those who do social science, I believe they have much better sense than me what each thing that we obtain may mean. So I'll be giving you our results, I'll be telling you how we obtained that one, and then you can help me to understand why it's like that. So this is very interesting. I come here to learn, first of all, and then to share with you what I already did.
Work?
Okay. So this agenda for the first part. So we go through different types of data. Textual data, visual data, location data, sensor data, and of course how to collect this data, because, well, if you can process it, but you don't know how to collect it, it wouldn't help us, we still cannot do anything. And visual data, currently, I just want to make some remark, is very commonly processed by deep nets. And these deep nets, they've been trained on some label, or maybe some semi-supervised manner, they can learn to predict something. So if you take one of the last layers of the deep net, this deep net can give you a very high level of representation of the data, either for videos, for keyframes, or for image data. I wouldn't be addressing this here because of two reasons. First reason, because even if you can get these values, we don't really know what is that, and it's not so useful in a modeling perspective. And second, because tomorrow will be another tutorial by a very experienced data scientist who worked with the neural net, and I think he'll tell you a lot about how to move the network. So he make my job a bit easier, so I don't need to address that. Okay? And yeah. All of us know that big data is not about data. Big data is about how to process it. What the thing to notice here is that it was found by an EEW research center that more than half users actually use more than one social network in their daily life. And they use them differently, and they achieve different goals by using the different social networks. It's not just like I want to register places and that's all use. Now each of them help us to release some emotions, help us to communicate to others in a certain way. Like LinkedIn, for example, can be for very professional communication, but Twitter can be for some recent comments, and Instagram can be for sharing the pictures without even maybe any comments, just because we want to share something that we just see and it was a friend of it. So all these data sources, they present users in 360-degree view. That's why they must be considered. So take example of Twitter, right? Twitter will be mostly textual view, but of course it's also diverse, so some images inside there. Then Instagram is a image view, right? It's a visual view. For example, Foursquare, which is already not that popular, but is still the largest standalone location-based social network, will be giving you the view of location, not just location. Point of interest, which is related to the semantics of location, which in turn are very much related to who we are, what we do, and so on. And of course, we have, all of us have this wearable device. How many of you have wearables on your hand? Oh, okay, not so many. Then we can do one more research on this. Why sometimes people don't wear sports wrappers? In the next. Yeah, so we have these wearable devices, and these wearable devices track us all the time. And being combined all these types of data together, we can actually get a 360-degree view on the person. And that's our ultimate goal. So this Mr. Cover is surrounded by the social network. Let's start from the textual data first. How many of you do NLP, just to let me roughly understand? Okay. Yeah, so quite many. I'll just be briefly going through the basic concepts, so everybody will roughly understand. So we have something called n-graphs. N-graphs is a sequence of words, and for n-graphs it's important to have the exact sequence of words, as well as their coherence together. So basically, d-graphs and single graphs are just words, it's also a specific case of n-graphs. And many of us are working with unigraphs, not with n-graphs. Because n-graphs requires a lot of data. And I think for you it's probably obvious why do n-graphs require so much data to be processed and efficiently work with them? Can anybody tell me? At least those who write scan and say that.
Yeah,
we need to have a very large corpus to work with n-graphs.
Because if you have a small corpus, many of them will have very low frequencies.
Then we will maintain a coherence. Yeah. And if they have low frequency, why is it better for them to have low frequency?
Models will predict better.
So this is in a computer science perspective. But I would say in social science it would be the same thing. If you have some multiple n-graphs with a very low frequency, it doesn't make sense. We cannot draw much conclusion because everything you will find will eventually wouldn't lead us to any statistically significant result, which wouldn't let us draw any conclusion out of it.
Yeah, that's correct.
So, and the simplest model we can do is just uniformly distribute probabilities when you work with these words. It's smarter way is a full so-called Bell-Mor strategy when you compute the probability of hearing the word. Basically, just count how many times we see this word inside the corpus, and then it will be a probability of this word occur. And also, we can compute the conditional likelihoods. How likely this word will occur given enough words. And one example is like a mythical unicorn is much more likely than a mythical popcorn. So this requires gender distribution. And we can have also called Bagel and Grams models. And these models, they basically distributions of occurrence of a certain n-grams inside our corpus. And this is already very useful because this, you know, work cloud that we build to visualize our data, some simple models that we train the large corpuses for predicting something. They all, many of them, looking on as simple as n graphs and mini graphs, and this becomes much more useful than some very sophisticated things, like on the web and so on. So, if it's something simple, doesn't mean it doesn't work. I would say large data sometimes are much more crucial than the complex data itself. And then, how many of you know this guy? His name is James Clifford and Pepper. Anybody know? Did you heard about LIWC? Okay. So LIWC is a dictionary that was invented by this guy. This guy himself is a linguist, and he was studying how does word usage reflect our personality? How the words we use is related to our personality, the way we behave to other people, the way we behave online, and so on. So he wrote a book called The Secret Life of Pronouns. And just that book is very interesting already because he's finding some very interesting relationships, like people who say I all the time, they're actually followers most of the time. And those who say we, they're actually leaders potentially. There are also a number of words that are related to anger, there's a number of words related to war, and so on and so on. So what he ended up, he's created the dictionary called the LIWC dictionary. And this dictionary is just a word. And basically, just a set of words that are meaningful to distinguish one type of personality of a person to another. So he found these crucial words that disintegrate personalities the most. Call it LWC, it's 69 categories. Recently they came up with something called LWC2, it's a hierarchical structure. Well, the first version is just a dictionary, so all of them have the same level. But basically the idea is always the same. So it looks like this. Every person represented by a text can be represented by a histogram of occurrence of different types of words. Here is not all purpose, of course, it's just some example. And just by using this histogram, we can look for people who are similar to some potential being extrovert or introvert, for example, some other personality aspects. Maybe some of you study this better, so you can tell me how exactly it can be used in social science perspective. We were using it in computer science perspective, so we were training the models. And we found that models being trained just on LWC can actually outperform many sophisticated techniques you can work with for the national image processing. And this is very easy to use. All of you can just go download this program called LWC Lite, and you can run it on the corpus and get a distribution of given corpora just right now in 5 minutes. And this is already a very meaningful representation of a text. So I wouldn't be teaching you to do this. You have multiple technical mentors, so and also, there is a version of the dictionary itself uploaded in the internet somewhere. So actually, I can just download it. Somebody already created the program. I didn't say that. Okay. So, and then, another meaningful thing, I also wouldn't be going too much into detail, but it's important to mention, it's a topic modeling. Topic modeling basically is a family of probabilistic generative models.
that without training data
can tell us the distribution of our
documents
among the topics.
What is document? Document is a set of words, basically a Bergman word model.
So by training this generic model, for example LDA, one of the most popular ones, iteratively,
and fitting into the distribution, you eventually can get a distribution of this given text among some latent topics. So it's not topics that we define. These topics will be eventually coming out, so our job, our next job will be say what each topic means, how to say, how to label these topics. We also have the distribution of topic among the words, and well, just remark, words, not necessarily real word. Word can be wherever token, wherever thing, from wherever type of modality, not necessarily real word. So give us distribution of this topic among words, and by seeing which words are the most popular in this topic, we can give a name to the topic. For example, this topic is about food, this topic is about travel, and something else. This is another very powerful thing to study the data. And I believe many of you may consider to use it during school because it's, again, it's extremely easy to use it by tools provided by our colleagues, by tools you can download from internet, all languages supported, whatever language you like, you can just find it and run. And you will get which topics are inside your text. Very useful to understand because topics are much higher level structures compared to words themselves. And understand what actual components of this text generated by people. And again, I wouldn't be addressing this too much because you'll get another tutorial to this later by Professor Alessa. She'll be telling a lot about generic topic models, right? Yeah, so just, I'm very lucky. I mean, most of the things I don't need to tell you because we have nothing.
So I just take a part of giving you an overview to make you have a good start. And this is just an example. So we have four topics here, and each topic consists of some words like brain, neuron, nerve, and life, evolve, organization, and we have probabilities of this topic, of this word occurring inside this topic. So by taking these top few words, we can actually give a name to the topic. For example, the third topic would be about brain, about neuroscience, most likely. The last topic data. This is a typical example of a document. This is a proper document, not a Twitter. So Twitter, they have models that I am able to work with a very short text. For example, one of them was developed by Singapore Management University years ago called Twitter LDA. So they try to handle that issue by globalization. And there's a multiple processes. Here in Russia, they have something called big RTM that found also variation of topic models is able to work with multi-modal data. It also can be downloaded and used. Just Google it, and you can ask me, of course, when you find something useful. And here we have an example where a Twitter user may sum up all his text in Twitter because it's unreliable to use single tweets that are too short for model to provide reliable results. So we sum up all the text, only the text always some long period of time, at least 10-20, right? So we get a document, so each user is a document. But we run the model on it, and we get a probability distribution. So each user will be a distribution. And this distribution, again, can be used for social science, just to understand who these users are, to find the similar guys, or can be fitted into the model, because models, machine learning know how to work with this kind of data. So, taking all the model, we can try it before, and those who try already, and then, of course, we can also come up with some heuristical features. And for example, as I told you later, for gender and age detection, this heuristical feature is extremely powerful. They are manually crafted by men. And these features belong to social network features as well as some linguistic and stylistic features. For example, it can be number of hashtags, number of slang words. We use some slang dictionary. Find the heuristics of slang words, or for example, number of URLs. The interesting ones are the sentiment scores, sentiment level, which is the modular of the sentiment score, plus mistakes and mistakes.
interestingly, people of different age and of even different BMI have very different characteristics of how many mistakes and misspellings they do. And this is one of my biggest favorite questions that I'll ask social scientists. I'll ask you the same question later, which is the relation between your polymath index and number of mistakes you do in text. I have many assumptions, but it really is so interesting, so I want to know your opinion debate in the second part of the lecture. And then we go to the visual data. Anybody do visual data processing here? Anybody? Any visual data, images, videos, keyframes, anything? Okay, computer scientists, right? Okay. Okay, so social scientists are the rest, I assume. Okay, and somebody probably belongs to both fields, right? So, this another a bit old-fashioned way to work with images, but it gives you a good sense of understanding actually how what the kind of data representation can be given from the images. So we have an image here, and we can detect the directions of the edges inside this image. Edges themselves can be detected by the image gradient. Basically, it's related to how fast the intensity of the color changes. So, like if you have a picture of a cat here, I don't know if you see or not, then by looking gradient on this picture, you can get actually the edges of the cat. And this edges have a direction. So, if you split the picture into segments, then each of the segments will have certain direction from 0 to 360 degrees. So, we can split this sentence maybe in a larger segments, and then for each segment, count the most popular direction. And it will build a histogram from 0 to p. This is a very basic concept, and this kind of histogram, which is an array of values, which is a vector, we already can do a lot of other things. And we feed it in machine learning models, we can look for several pictures for information to you, or we can try to understand, for example, what this group of pictures have in common, so that in terms of edges, these pictures are very close to each other. And then we may find that these pictures are taken by people of similar gender or personality, or people who have similar friends, similar behavior. These kind of things are very interesting to discover. If you guys want to do some research on cross-source, cross-modal directions, it will be very interesting. I myself doing this research for already 4 years, and we can do a lot of things to discuss. So, this is just this example I use. So we have these four quadrants, four regions, and each of these regions distributed is basically a histogram. This histogram is about what is the directions of these images inside there. So this is the representation of the four images. So, but this thing is not that useful for us because most of the times we will be taking very small regions of the picture, and then we can get some kind of bank of visual words, bank of visual words set that will be related to this image. It will be enough for machine to understand which images are similar, but for us it will be a little bit too meaningful. So a bit later I will tell you actually what else we can use for this to understand the content of the image and the meaning and the semantics of the image. But by now I need to introduce one more concept to you called SIFT. SIFT. Anybody heard about SIFT? Huh? I guess somebody heard about SIFT. Yeah, so basically idea here is not too far from just the directional histogram of images. We take this images represented as histograms, and we perform a clustering on them. And this cluster can be any kind of cluster, and the one popular ones is the hierarchical keyframe cluster. And then we can get the groups of these images that are close to each other. So we then say that these groups, these clusters, are called visual words because they are larger and they are comfortable. So with these visual words, we already can further work, and it's already much better. We have much better understanding what is this image.
rather than just working with some very low level features like an edge. So just example of the clustering. Multiple nodes. These nodes are our low level features, and then we divide the space. Still, we get the final result of the clustering. This cluster is the algorithm. So you can put the boxes to see the work. You can get this kind of tree, and this will be already the visual tree. And this is really very useful. If you look at the visual work, you can see many things. Libraries you can work. So, and that is summarized, represent the image as a histogram itself. I'm not histogram of something low level, but histogram of the visual world, some high level concepts. We can go a step further and make it even more nicer for people to understand. So now we have a picture. Sorry, it's a bit blurry on the screen, but it's okay. By the way, this guy is a mainland. It's a main symbol of Singapore. I come from Singapore, so I must put some pictures in Singapore landmark, as well as my professor later on this one. Yeah, so here you can see the stadium. You can see these green circles. These green circles actually is the detected objects. And these objects are trees. And trees is a visual concept. Tree is something human already understands. So this is the pictures, these are many trees, and maybe this is a statue, maybe this is a people, and maybe this is a stairs. So we can see the distribution of the concepts. So it actually looks very useful if a computer can run some algorithm on millions of pictures fast and tell what is on each picture. And this works surprisingly very, very well. The latest models are neural nets models. So it's usually they don't work with SIF descriptors. They don't work with data directly. But even by using SIF descriptors and the representation of the data I saw in the previous slide, you can get very nice result as simple as by using SVM. How many of you know SVM?
Yes.
Okay, so basically it works this way. We have some learning, we combine these images in the form of a couple of words, which is a cluster of images of these images, and we fill in some model. This model learns how to predict certain concepts, for example, tree detector, or a rabbit detector, or whatever concept detector. So now we have thousands of these kind of models. We run our image on all of these models, and we can get distribution of this image among these concepts. And surprisingly, this one is also very nicely available. And on top of that, we also made an API. So all of you can actually use this API, sending us an image, and immediately get a distribution among concepts of this image. So you can utilize it in summer school. And don't need to go too deep to work with images. You can just use it. I'll give you a username and the password later, so you can try that. Also, you can give us feedback about our API, because it's just an alpha version of React Extension. Yeah.
Yep. Is it available on the web, or we can integrate it
in the code?
Again? The
API
can be integrated
to
the
code
center, or
is it available
on the web?
Yeah, it is it's RESTful API. You can use it as a service. Well, partially the technology inside is published in our papers. We have more than 20 papers around this thing just in a few years before, but the best way to use API is just use it as a service from our platform. You can use it for free and also it's not
problem.
I like to introduce it. And yeah, so basically this can be handled as a classification problem, and then if we build some zebra detection model, it can detect zebras from non-zebras. And then we look at another 999 and another 10,000 concepts. And then we can get a model that can tell us what is in the picture. And then we can build a distribution of what is an average on the pictures of this user. So now, in a matter of few milliseconds, we can get complete understanding of who this person is,
based on what data he posted. And it's very strange not to use this kind of opportunity. So I'll tell you later how to do that.
Well, and more of it by creating more about generally machine learning techniques. And then the next one is location data. Location data is very broad level of what are many sources of location data. One can be the explicitly indicated location, for example, it can be the POI targeted by Facebook or Foursquare or some any other social network users that are checked in here, so you know what this location is. Another source of location could be the metadata of the image. Sometimes the camera is saving the location information inside the image. Another source of location can be these locations available provided by telco companies. They basically say they give very long tracks of rough location of user, but I can still understand roughly how these people move in the city. So all these telco companies, they make use of this data a lot to solve some business problems as well, like distribution of advertisements and so on, as well as the problems of problems related to some government, like for example, claiming facilities and so on and so on. So you can see that in some area people travel very far all the time, it means there's not enough facilities for them. In some other place, they may be too lazy and too far, don't travel at all. So maybe this might be so, that's the main social networks for this kind of data. And I believe the very first one was called Dodgeball, and these guys was doing exactly the same as Foursquare, but then they were acquired by some other company. So the founders of the Dodgeball give all the code to the company and then promote them, make a copy of this code from Foursquare and make one more server that eventually become popular. So Foursquare wasn't the first mover, but the founders of Foursquare were the first movers in location-based services. And then everybody picked it up, like Google, like Facebook, everybody wanted to put this Instagram as well, which gives us a very large pool of selection where we can put this kind of data. Main competitors, main providers of the service can be considered Facebook and Foursquare, but yeah, Instagram, which is part of Facebook, also has a big role in this. So, it's a different types of data, even on social related to location to social media services. It's not just location itself, which is not truly useful, especially if it's sparse. But it's also social relations of this guy. Obviously, he's cooking with beer and so on. And temporal relations, which is how he moves in the urban environment as well as how he posts, which is also his mobility, just virtual mobility. Then it's geodata itself, which is one of the questions, and is some communication of this person with others, reports, retweets, as well as his social graph. So location-based service is a very sweet type of social network, except for normal social network attributes has a very nice feature of giving location and semantics of this location. So how we work with that? The most obvious and very powerful way, and is applicable to all of you again, is just take a guy from the data set or from social network itself, download his or her check-ins, and then represent this person as a distribution among the categories of these check-ins. Of course, we can distribute among actual places, but it may happen that the vector will be very large because the distribution must be the same for all users. And it will be very sparse, so it will be the same problem as with M-RAM and small datasets. But if we use the categories of the social network, for sure, particularly, it used to have 764 categories, but I believe now we already have more, maybe 5 more categories. The one you told me last time, how many categories? So this is our data. Okay. Yeah. So, and these categories, there's different types of places where a person is. So his snapshot of his
location-based social network activity gives us a very nice picture of who this person is based on the places where he goes. And one of our students actually found the challenge by monitoring where a person goes and the time where he goes. Can easily tell does this person have a boyfriend, girlfriend, or married or not. It is just very simple to tell that thing. And that inspired us for another research topic, and that research topic is very famous. I'll tell you a bit later. But in general, this is very powerful data source as well, and all of us must know that just having a lot of data and just applying some models on it is not enough. You must think a lot about what type of data logically can be useful for what type of applications. And this is where social scientists might must help computer scientists, because computer scientists sometimes are too fast in modeling, too uncareful in thinking before the actual research starts. Then, in another way, make it even more general is apply the topic modeling on it, right? I told you about the LDAs. So here, the words will be location categories. For example, I visited train station two times. It will be, my document will contain two words, train station. And then I visit, for example, airport one time, so I will go one more word airport. So all my activity will be number of words. And these words, of course, in terms of topic models, it doesn't matter which word follow what, because it's unigram. But yeah, we can go to more sophisticated case and just try to monitor which location follow which location, then we can put spatial compactness as well, and become a monitor. But generally, now we have 764 categories, and we convert them into some n categories which are much smaller than 764, like 10 or 20. Each of them will be a set of corresponding location types. And we can say what general topics, location topics of this person. And again, this can be done very easily. Two steps. First step, get the data and compute the distribution of the locations. Second step, run LDA. You can run any conventional LDA. Now you can get some very interesting representation of data. Each of all of you can 1 hour, no problem. Again, how to make it, I wouldn't teach you, I would tell you something else, but it's really easy, and ask all these mentors that are talking this. So, and this is an example, right? So we have, for example, six topics. And this is real data from US NSS data set, one of the data sets provided to you. So we run it on all users, on location data of these users, and we get these six topics. Six was determined empirically, just topics make sense. When you go a bit higher than six, some topics not too useful. And also can be turned by something called perplexity, but perplexity also not always work well, so there are many ways to work with it. Just try to play with it and see which one is the best for you. So here you can see topic one is about Malay restaurant, Mall, university, Indian restaurant, Asian restaurant, so many restaurants, different types of restaurants. So we call the food bars, for example. And then we have travel topic, poetry, wars, family, guys, students topics, and some teenager use topics. But teenager means not the age, teenager means the lifestyle of teenager, of course. And this just three users random examples from the data set, so you can see the solution of each of them among this. Here are examples of, six topics here. You can see the distribution of each of the students among these six topics. So you can see some people are very, very different from each other, so you can distinguish them easily. To do large scale data processing, you don't need to do any more manual processing. At the same time, you can do very nice social science or computational social science research on this. You don't need to go to technical stuff. And except for that, of course, we can utilize the location data itself. For example, we can use something called area of interest. Area of interest is a cluster of locations where we go often. And if you do this kind of clustering, it can be spatial clustering. This kind of algorithm or some other algorithms, it's special clustering or maybe geographical clustering. You can get these areas of interest in the map. And the largest, most popular area of interest, most of the times, will be either your home office. So, users, they no longer, they don't need to ask them where they live or where
state. We already know where the different universe state. And then out of this location of their home or office or some place they go off, for example, person house, we can know the places where to go, correspond to this area of interest, as well as the number of this area of interest, as well as the number of outliers, so how often people would like to discover something new, which is again very related to personality, very related to job, to many things. And you can say the distance. Some people like stay in a very local place, go in the same time every time, and they don't travel far from their work as well, from office. But some people like really travel a lot. And this kind of indicators can dismiss them very, very well. That's very useful. And then Dr. Novas, he will be presenting the sixth of July here in school. He's done a lot of research on location-based services. So this is a picture taken from one of his papers. So he monitored what type of features fluctuate with the time and space, and which are undoubtedly fluctuating, so they are more or less stable, so it can be used for creating some predictive models. Again, features are very, very simple. For example, how is the particularity of the place, the physical distance from the person that goes to go to a certain place, and maybe the place of the day, the hour of the day. And here you can see the degrees. So you can see those ones that are stable, but they're not features. Those are not stable. But at least you must consider this temporal aspect, because if you just train a model on Sunday and compare it with Monday, and this type of features also very useful. So they can be used to study the regulars, to do quantitative analysis. And then you have a sensor data. This is something very recent. I'm very happy to look at this because you managed to get very large sensor data sets. This one that is provided to you, all the newest sets. That data set is about 140,000 workouts of the people. And we are currently working on another data set in the US. That data set is about 15 million workouts and several million of users. So it's really, really representative data of the whole world. That one we didn't release yet because we didn't get our publication first to but that one that we have already very large. In fact, that one that we have already largest in the world, especially considering that they have all other social networks. I'll talk about it later in the end. So, how do we represent sensor data? Well, we have some workouts. People workouts consist of semantics, the type of workout that you're running, or jogging, or doing some gym exercise. And just presenting user again as a distribution among these activities. That's already a very good thing for training a model. It's also a very good thing to understand what the whole population of the data set. So, one to work with sensor data, look at this first. It's a very semantically rich thing because you don't need to predict, you definitely know what type of exercise this person is doing because it's self annotated. Unless the person is running and doing actually something else, try to freak out. Data set sufficiently large, so you're not really bothered about that. Yeah, so you can get this kind of distribution. So the idea is the same as in the previous types. And another way we can do is actually work with actual sensor data. It's the changes of location, changes of the altitude, changes of the heart rate. We have a heart rate data itself inside. And how we can do it? We can move into the frequency domain. So who knows how to change the sequential data and move it to frequency domain. What we need to do with it? Any simple way? Basically, what we're looking for here is to get the workouts of different lengths. Some can consist of 100 points, some of 1,000 points, to be represented as a fixed size vector. No, for those who study simple physics or math, I know that it's such simple Fourier transform.
fast version of Fourier transform. We can project the sequences of applications or sequences of whatever I'm saying into one representation of the one frequency representation, one spectrum representation. And then we come up with these spectrums, further distributing them on unknown beams. So now wonder, doesn't matter how many data points in our sequence we have, we can represent them, for example, as a vector of the array of 100 or of 200 or whatever. And then we can do it for each of the modalities of the data, and then we can get the full representation. Let me know if somebody wants to run that. I have a Python script. Maybe not everybody will work in this sensor data, so I didn't upload it, but I can just pass to you. You can run and get from raw data, I can get fixed representation of this data in a formula vectors. And of course, you can count number of locales, average x rays, ascend, descend, see the age and gender of these people, which is not really keeping the group, but I think it's not because it's useful representatives. And you can get the oxygen consumption, which is actually not measured by center, but it's approximation computed based on the speed, the slope, and the heart rate of the moment. And this is not a nice research thing, the heart rate or not, but we just use it because we create models on this, so we need some nice representation of oxygen data consumption. We should directly relate it to your health and fitness status. So this is just the overall picture. We have the textual features, image features and sensor features. And each of them, these features of data representation, are very, very different, very diverse. So in machine learning, in the computer science perspective, one of the biggest challenges here, okay, given so diverse, incomplete data, how can you train the models to make use of it and make it actually work better than if you train on a single data source? And when we come up with this idea, initially many conventional scientists were doubting that it would work. They were using some single sources, like some labs still people text. But I would say, based on my experience and all my papers, I definitely can say that single source data always work worse in terms of prediction or recommendation accuracy compared to multi-source models. And it's easy to explain. First, as long as the data describe users in very diverse view, second, there's much more data. If we utilize the visual information, it's like if human will close his eyes, stop smelling all the ears, and then we'll start arguing that he actually can sense the world better than those who do all these types of senses.
Okay.
So basically, we're talking a lot about data,
and this data is we basically have assumption that
this kind of data is available to us. So our basic assumption is like this. Okay, now we have the data sources, data points, and what is very important is that we have the mapping between user accounts from one social network to another social network. So we know exactly who this user is in another social network. There is also another researcher who is trying to map this automatically, but don't address that. We need to know how to find exactly the same user in different social networks. So I want to ask you, how would you do this? If you have multiple social networks and you want to map one user to another, and you want to do it in a reliable way, so you don't want to get too many. Again? Look for names.
Links.
For links.
Well, so if you go to research on how to map these users to each other, there are many techniques.
For example, use user names and
they say that a very big overlap of user names exists in different social networks, so we can map or we can create some models and we try to predict whether this user belongs to certain social network or not, and try to find the similar users in different modalities in this way to match them one to another.
Then there is another very, very reliable way. I'm going to put it aside, but I can tell you because some of you may utilize it in your research.
There's web pages, one of them called, for example, about.me, about.me. So very interestingly, people go there and say, JavaScript recently paused. This is my Twitter, this is my Facebook, this is my LinkedIn, and so on and so on and so on. So basically, they use it as, should we close the window? So people basically try to make their online identities diverse, online identities to show what who they are, and they do this for different purposes. Some people are very public, so they want to refer to their actual account, they don't want to refer to fake accounts. Some other people, they want to be draw more connections, so they do this web page to some of the people just have fun, and we found that many of users of this about.me web page and other similar, they are certain bias and demographics. So it's usually young people, those who don't take care of privacy. But of course, there are some examples from older generation. Like I know one researcher. Computer science, very famous. He doesn't have any social media accounts. I meet him in the US quite often. And then I know his friend in the US who has all possible social media accounts. And then the first professor, he always gets published by another one when he visits him. So even though he may know one, others know where he exactly, another professor always put a selfie with him so everybody knows where he is. It's one of NUS professors. And another one is a professor from US, he's doing also social media analytics. I mean, both of them are famous. Yeah, so it's like this. And the problem of demographic bias didn't let us use this straightforward approach of using these kind of platforms, because if you want to predict some demographic attributes, for example, age and gender, and it doesn't make sense for us to grow the platform where everybody is 10 to 30 years old and we don't have anybody older. So, we follow the idea that was proposed as a first version of how to do it. We monitor the so-called cross-linking activities for users, where one user posts something in another social network about himself. We were using these four social networks because each of them is a very bright representative of the type of the social network. And the idea of problem is like this. We have many social media accounts. Many people repost their posts inside Twitter. And the funny thing is that if you like Instagram, for example, you think that you want to repost, later Instagram will never ask you, do you want to repost again? It will just by default repost everything you post, you may forget about that, which is not so good for privacy of the person, but very good for us, for researchers. Because you'll get not biased by this fact, and you can really get those pictures that person may not want to be released. And we roll them this way, and for example, the Endemondo network, which is very recent, data source, I recommend all of you to try the very nice data source of sensitive data and the social media activity introduced in our recent policy paper. Idea is like this: we have some workout, some guy, and then another, and then we have some random guy, somebody. And then what we can get a report from this guy in his Twitter. And then this Twitter can be monitored by some crawler using some legal way like IP
API, Twitter Stream API, or Twitter REST API. And every time that there are repos on Twitter, we can monitor them. In the case of Foursquare, for example, we can only crawl those posts that are republished to Twitter because Foursquare doesn't let us crawl their posts themselves. Which was true about 6 years ago. Actually, let people do that. So, Mr. Novolas was lucky to get his very large data sets at that time, but currently the research is not at this opportunity, so we only have to use those that repos to Twitter. But for some other social networks like Mondo, like Instagram, we actually can get the idea of a user crawl everything for this person in a reasonable web page. So give the polls and then the person get very, very large multi-source data sets. And that's the beauty of this. I encourage all of you consider to do research on this kind of application. Do it multi-source, it's the future, and it's obviously we'll be moving to that direction. Also, I'm not mentioning the video, but video is another extremely popular type of data, and Professor Shortat Sen tomorrow will be talking about it more, so I'm likely again going to talk about it. So, this is basically my idea. And this is the second part of my talk. Because first is much shorter than the second, but I will start it a bit, so you will have more time for questions in the second part, as well as I will have time to describe the data sets. And then I will start my other colleague to describe another data set that they will work together with more, so you can get a comprehensive overview. And tonight you're already very, very well prepared, and you can start working. How many of you, by the way, found your groups? Know who is in your group, know the people in your group. Anybody? So, like, we look at this table, right? Since the table, we look at a lot of people sign up for the
group. I can see there one third part of all have signed in the table in the spreadsheet.
Okay, guys, you have this very boring tutorial, by me, so you have a very good chance to sign up to a group at least. Right, so you can use this opportunity. So by evening, when you'll be producing the data sets during your lunch break, they expect everybody roughly know what they want to work on, so it will be much easier for us to help you and much easier for you to start straight away. So tonight you already can get some initial results, so tomorrow when you come back, our mentors, our helpers will know exactly how to help you, so make it the most efficient. So let's make this Russian summer school the best, most efficient summer school of all the history. Because I'm from Russia, I'm interested in it. Right? Not the best summer school. So let's see the results. Everybody will come up with a paper in the end. Okay. So here's just a quick recall. So when I'll be talking about profiling, I'll be talking about different applications that can be achieved for using this kind of multi-source data. And of course, the model that you're using are not that simplistic. And if you want to understand any details, please go to my academia webpage, which is usacademia.edu/mahabrenfrc. Or you can just go to my personal webpage, all papers are there, and download and read. But I will give you a sense of what type of models can be used to get some very meaningful results in different domains, in different sub-applications of this field. And then I will talk about some business applications in the end, as well as conclude the whole talk. And I will be talking about data sets in this moment as well. So everybody must stay towards the end, otherwise you will miss some very relevant data set in production. All my slides will be available tonight on my web page and I believe in the school web page as well. I probably post a video as well that I'm now shooting. There are some interruptions, but hopefully you understand everything, as well as the screencast of this talk. Okay, so how many of you know this guy, okay? maybe they are politicians, more politicians than social scientists. Well, when I started from him, that's an interesting story. One of the persons in here, she decided, well,
I worked on social media data last time, and I found that it's so nice to monitor social media users by where they go in terms of locations. Types of places that I said before, the type of places you visit reflects your relationship status. Except for she is monitoring her boyfriend in this way in social media. She also decided to do research on it, so she extended and started work on multi-source learning for relationship status prediction. I didn't include this paper inside there. You can read this paper in AAAI Proceedings 2017. And also this one inside our API, so you can use this model to predict relationship status. The funny thing is that after we published the model, we published the paper, somebody decided, well, let's run this model with the politicians. And they run this model on two politicians. One was this guy, another one was Barack Obama. And in the case of Barack Obama, the marital status was detected correctly, he's married. But unfortunately for Trump and the whole world in terms of Trump, it was detected wrongly. It was detected as a single. And journalists take over care of it so well. So after they published this paper, about 60 articles all over the world, from China to US, started publishing that even AI thinks that Trump is a bachelor, he's single. No wonder he treats his wife in a certain way. That's why AI is detected. So, of course, in my perspective, there is a risk because when they run it in the Trump profile, they only run it in textual data. They didn't utilize other data sources. The first reason why they detect wrongly, so the reported accuracy of 86% was reported for multi-source data, but they run it only in textual data. And the second is, I believe, a lot of tweets in Trump's account actually from his assistants, not from Trump himself. So it could be some young guy or girl who indeed single and model actually predicted correctly. So that's actually explanation. But I found it very, very, very funny to talk to journalists and discuss why AI thinks that Trump is single and how it's relevant to other opinions of the crowd and the public. So you can Google Trump lecture where you'll find all these articles. Very, 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 very funny to read. You have free time. But you need to solve your assignments first, okay? Before you do this kind of thing. Basically, what is user profile? User profile can be many, many different things. It can be the demographics of the person, it can be the location of the presentation, the affiliation to some user communities, so social graphs, sensor data. And since 50% of users already use more than one social network, at the same time, these social networks represent persons from a very diverse view, and the lab is profiling. Be done in 360 degree perspective. That's why it calls 360 degree profiling. You can find a paper called 360 degree user profiling. That one more thorough paper about general our vision. Yeah. And now, other works, instead of the paper, we address different issues of user profiling, different components of user profiling. There is individual user profiling and group user profiling. User profiling in our works consists of some identity profile as well as some wellness profile, or we can call it physical profile. So identity profile in terms consists of age, consists of gender, and consists of our risk of work and personality, which is not published yet but is submitted to one of the conference or some review now. So if some of you are reviewers of the people, let me know. And then wellness profile is he was looking at some weight-related problems in his obesity systems. And then we have a group profile, which is groups, user communities. So all these things in observatory results for the 360 degree, and it's all from open source. And the core overall framework for business, or just framework for the session, they look like this. We have social media users. These users have social media data, as well as digital data from sensors. Then this data can be, we can detect groups of users,
based on some algorithms and cluster approaches that we develop as long as some of these people, so there is a lot of people proposed recently. So we have the full representation of these people because they're
community affiliation,
as well as their demographic attributes, as well as their physical attributes. So all these can go to platforms. These platforms go to social discovery or social listening services, like by popular. No, not that comprehensive part. And that can provide the view of people on the world. So, for example, if you have a brand, you sell something, you can find, so also mention this brand inside social media, and then you start monitoring these people, and you can get community that they belong to, demographic attributes, their even physical attributes, everything. Just imagine how sweet it was also on a brand, how nice it they can readjust their marketing and advertising policies in order to reach some goals. So we actually have one topic in our topics, it's about the business. So those who sign up there, I expect you guys not just producing models, but doing something, but you know why and for what it is. I want you looking more into where it can be useful, some business cases, maybe some market of this. Of course, you can do full market research and everything. But as long as you come up with some very nice idea, this is already very good. And you know, this research direction recently got very popular, even this year, multimedia, this year, for a workshop on business application of multimedia. So if you guys can come up with some nice business idea now, after 1 year, you can get first round paper there that will even forward it to VCs for potential funding. So, and the data, I'll just repeat why I repeat here, because those techniques that I presented in the beginning, they are general. Out of those techniques, it took some that we are using for our models. And these techniques are more or less similar to those machine learning models that we train among most of our works. So I just summarized here once, and later I wouldn't touch data, I'll just touch the machine learning part. Also, later when you read it, also you can comprehensively learn about data sets that you see here. So that's why I also tell you here that, you couldn't see at all, but you could see in your document. Maybe in this kind of atmosphere I can speak longer. That's always my problem. Long to long is going to be a problem. Yeah. So, it's a way to use two data sets. One is a new SMSS, another one is a new SMS. Based on this data set, we publish at least three hierarchical mini supplementary papers on this. So, we kind of very well studied the data and asked me personally or some of our mentors on the data set. And all I will be speaking forwardly will be related to these two data sets. Just following maybe six slides, summarizing what type of data processing approaches we use to feed it into machine learning models. So, for text, we use 69. Let's kind of quiz. What is a WC equivalent number? Frequency of usage for us related to personality. Well, this speech should tell you everything about it. This will wake up. So, the second one is topic models. We use an LDN to determine the number of topics based on the perplexity values. So, when the slope of perplexity, not slope, but the shape of perplexity values change, we treat that as an optimal number of topics. But this is just one way. Many other people just heuristically look at the topics and say which number it has. So most of the times it was 50 or 51 or 40 something, so we just keep it 50 most of the time. And maybe it's more or less uniform, so we can use different data sets for different models, but we can
browser would be more efficient.
And then aside for that, we have manually crafted features, and these features are hashtags, number of hashtags, number of semaphores, number of URLs, user mentions, the average sentiment level, which is detected by our own sentiment engine. It's based on the dimensional sentiment analysis, which is Web of Words and SVN plus emoticons, emojis, so a few, a couple of dictionaries related to sentiment from Wikipedia as well as from SentiWordNet. SentiWordNet is a version of WordNet that has sentiment for
then we have emotion words obtained from SentiWordNet, we have emoticons, and we have language sentiments for number of misspellings.
This was computed by Microsoft Word spell checker. Don't be afraid that you don't use every single Microsoft Word. But this is a good one, so we use it. We call it from directly from operation system, so just for user, because it's embedded in Windows itself.
And then we use some unknown words. Unknown words, those words are never in dictionary, so we assume that this is this completely wrong word, maybe this word is just
And then we count the average number of terms. So for images, we extracted the image consent.
So every user in our case is represented as a distribution of image consents. So every user has a fixed size of image consent distribution, which basically tells what this user usually posts about. And trained based on ImageNet, the actual model is a Google Net neural net. So we run it on GPU, it's pretty fast. Those in school who really want to use GPU, let me know, I'll give you a call server for them, okay? Really want to use it. So, all resources for you, just please come up with something nice. And then, all the applications, you use the distribution among the many categories, and the kind of ability features related to areas of interest. Then, further, we use the exercise stars, number of accounts, the heart rate, the oxygen consumption, and we feed it in a Fourier transform. Come up with a vector of 500, and this vector of 500 is basically a representation of user in terms of how they do activity in dynamics. So it's not just type of activity. It's, for example, how human body reacts on the slopes, how human body reacts on weather. We also can see the weather information because we have it, and how they correlate between each other, different coverage, from speed, and so on and so on. So very important. Some of you can try task of activity recognition here, because you have labels of all activities and you have raw data. Very simple task for this summer school if you want. We didn't do that yet, so but maybe you already have. And then the summary things. All these multiple sort of data goes somewhere.
Second part of the after 1 hour. Any questions so far? Okay.
I have one question.
Yeah.
What is the number of terms which you are discussing in the previous slide? Number of words. Now we call terms. No words that are already defined by system users. That's why they call terms of differentiation and for words, because all synonyms become one term.
One question for the sensor data. Yep.